worldwide. So you can imagine in every corner you can step in Egypt, there could be some kind of a monument, either forgotten or you enjoy it and you take some time to visit and explore the story behind this monument. Today we're going to talk about the forgotten monuments, and in particular in Fayoum. We have with us Mr. Sabir Abbas, researcher, Egyptologist and historian, and he's going to talk to us about the forgotten monuments and the stories behind those monuments, why they are forgotten. Good morning again, Mr. Abbas.
Good morning.
A very good morning to you, sir. As Dina said, we are going to speak about this unforgotten part, or this governorate, which is filled with monuments. And unfortunately, even Egyptians, do not know that much about the touristic sites of Al-Fayoum. Let us first take a quick look at the history of Al-Fayoum itself and the touristic site there, and then we are going to speak in detail about each.
So I'm very, very happy with the way you introduced the topic today, you know, the forgotten monuments. I was planning for another title, but I think that your title worked really well. I was planning about the hidden wonders of Egypt, which is there is in every place in Egypt, there is hidden treasures, hidden wonders. Mm-hmm. And when a Roman philosopher and historian, he chose seven wonders of the ancient world, I think that if we choose wonders in our country, in every destination, in every city, in every territory, we can choose at least seven wonders in every territory. So in Fayoum in particular, it is very important from a historical point of view, from all kingdom, from prehistory as well, we have the ancient Egyptian represented in the Fayoum area. Mm-hmm. Because it's very close to the Nile Valley, and it is connected with the Nile Valley with Bahr Yusuf or Joseph Canal. And in the Old Kingdom, there is a very interesting story. It dates back to the King Mina or Narmer. Mm. He was hunting. He was in a hunting tribe in Fayoum area in the west side of the lake. Mm. And he was attacked by his dogs, hunting dogs, and he was saved by a crocodile. And that's why the lake dedicated to the worship of the crocodile god. Mm-hmm. So the story might not be true, you know, so it might be made up by the priests of Sobek to attract the attentions to their area. But from this story and from other evidence there, we can tell that the ancient Egyptians, as early as the Old Kingdom, nearly 4,500 years old and even before that, they have a presence in Fayoum area. In the Middle Kingdom, which is nearly 3,800 years ago, we had lots of economical projects, farming projects. One of the oldest dams built in the history of mankind was built there, in order to save water during the flood time in the big depression, which is the lake of the Fayoum. Mm-hmm. And they built pyramids and they moved the capital of Egypt there as well. Mm-hmm. In the New Kingdom as well, we hear about the Fayoum, but not as much as it was, we hear about it in the Middle Kingdom. Mm-hmm. And then during the Greek and Roman period, the Fayoum advantages, location and fertile land, water, attracted their attention for lots of farming projects, and it was, they even invented new, in the ancient library of Alexandria, they invented a new irrigation system, which is known as the famous water wheel, which is still running in Fayoum today. And by inventing these wheels, they were able to irrigate more lands around the lake, and according to the historians back in that time, we are talking about nearly the 3rd century BC, they said, we created 365 villages, the products of every village can feed the entire Egyptian population for one day in the year. So that's in like in a very quick history, the history of Al-Fayoum.
Yeah.
And I brought some illustrations and photos with me, if you don't mind, you know, showing that. You know, we'll start with the map, which is the photo number. Actually, it has no number; it says zero.
Yeah.
Because when I finished the order of the photos, actually, I found that there is.
We do have the map already on air.
So in the map, you know, I put some arrows, and on the west side of the lake. Mm. So when we think about Al-Fayoum oasis, it comes to our mind the east side, not the west side. So, and that's why my focus today in the west side, which is very hidden part, and there is lots of famous attractions there, which is not explored and hardly being seen. And I will talk about why it was hidden, why there is hardly anybody there, and I also will talk about how we can promote this area. So in this map, there is arrows, which is in red, showing the different locations, which is, I will talk about it today. Mm-hmm. So to go to Al-Fayoum, instead of using the regular asphalt road, we will go from the west side. We need a 4x4 car. Mm-hmm. The advantage of Al-Fayoum area is, in a desert safari experience, in a desert trip, and instead of going to Al-Bahariya, if you have 2 days or a weekend trip from Cairo, so you drive nearly 600 kilometers to make it to the White Desert. Mm-hmm. But here only one hour from outside of Cairo, you get into the desert and you will see the following. First, you see an ancient basalt quarry from which they cut the stones, the basalt stones, which is used in the Great Pyramid, more specified in the Valley Temple. And that's how we will move to picture number two, I assume. Mm-hmm. Picture number three. So, picture number three. There is in within the forest basalt quarry, mm-hmm. and that was proven already that the stones which is used in the Valley Temple of King Khufu Pyramid, the Great Pyramid, that was taken from there. And the big surprise, actually, there is, you know, by the way, there is photo number four, which is, has the picture of Khufu Valley Temple, mm-hmm, which is showing the basalt blocks also being cut and shaped in place. Mm-hmm. The big surprise is, which is, that's what we can see in a photo, in a picture number five, is there is a paved road, dates back to 4,500 years ago. The Romans, they were known for paving roads, but the ancients actually, they built the oldest paved road in the history of mankind, the oldest known paved road in the history of mankind, and it is in this area. It was paved, and the foundation of this road is a petrified wood, mm-hmm, because there is a petrified forest there. And that's another geological wonder in this area. Big, huge trees has been submerged and covered and turned into stone. Mm-hmm. And that's what we can see in the photo number six of the petrified forest.
Mm. Right. Mm-hmm.
So that's not only the Old Kingdom quarry, and not only the oldest road in the history of mankind, we have also a Christian monument, which is very unique, called Deir Abu Lifa. Mm-hmm. Deir Abu Lifa could be 1,500 years old. Mm. Deir Abu Lifa, you can see it in the photograph number two, illustration photograph number two. Deir Abu Lifa is a genuine monastery. When we go to the monasteries today, it is built up. Has like cells that built up, mm-hmm, but before that, when the early Christians left the Nile Valley, escaping the persecution during the Roman period of time, mm-hmm, so they lived in caves. They had no money or no wealth to build like decent buildings. Mm-hmm. So Abu Lifa Monastery still have the cave as it is, mm-hmm, and the proof for that, which is the proof that it was used as a monastery, there is. There is another illustration which is showing Coptic graffiti, mm-hmm, on a plaster wall on the ceiling of this cave. A Coptic graffiti is from which we know the history of, mm-hmm, this monastery. Not only this attraction, which is just enough to attract attention to this area,
sure,
but also, mm-hmm, we have a temple built in the middle of nowhere. This temple known as, just a second, I will bring this temple picture from here. This temple known as, is, you know, I think this is temple picture number seven. Unfortunately, I cannot see the screen, so it is picture number seven. Mm. So this temple known as Qasr al-Sagha temple. Mm-hmm. And Qasr al-Sagha temple is built in the middle of nowhere, mm-hmm, built from huge blocks. Mm. You know, when we see these huge blocks, we know that there was a sophisticated civilization behind to cut these blocks, shape it and smooth it and move it. So. And unfortunately, it has no decorations, it has no inscriptions to know the exact date, but there is a very strong debate. It could be Old Kingdom or Middle Kingdom. So another ruins there, which is not far from Qasr al-Sagha, is Dimi al-Saba. Dimi al-Saba, that's in photograph number 8, if we can bring the photo number 8.
Mm-hmm. Mm. Here it goes.
Impressive sight. Mm. It is an impressive sight with giant walls over 25 meters height, mm-hmm, in the middle of nowhere again. Nobody go there. And that was an ancient Greek city. It has a temple. It has a wall. It has houses, beautiful luxury houses, completely buried with the sand. Myself, I spent like 2 hours crawling into one of these houses. When it was my head when I was crawling almost touching the ceiling, because it was all buried. It is not a virgin site, not excavated, connected with the lake. With,
is it still intact? I mean,
it's still in good condition. It's still buried, preserved. But the sad news is, there is illegal excavations happening in this area, and there's something which they've seen it, like grave robbers.
Okay.
You know, and that's something which I've seen it with my eye in different places.
No surveillance by the.
Pardon?
No surveillance, no inspection by the authorities.
There is guards there, but this area is a desert area. Mm-hmm. You cannot reach it with a regular car. You have to have a 4x4 cars, equipment, and camping and all that. I don't think that guards' number is enough to protect this area. So I've seen different illegal excavations in this area, and that's like a treasure hunters there. And unfortunately, they made a severe
damage to the area, of course.
To the area.
And to the buildings.
And to the caves, to the caves of the monastery as well, because they were assuming that there are treasures hidden there, and to the temple, by the way. There
is
a temple in the cave. And that might be just a warning, you know. So this area had a wonderful things, which is already there, and there is other things which is not excavated yet. So then, from the main Sabah, we are talking about an ancient Greek city dates back to nearly the 3rd century BC, 2,300 years ago. So moving on, you know, so we were still driving with our 4x4 car around the lake side, you know, making turn around the southern tip of the lake. That's where we will make it to Rayan Valley and the Wills.
This needs a full other episode.
So just mentioning, like, you know, we have Rayan Valley, we have the Magic Lake, which is also in illustration number 11. We have the Wills Valley, which is illustration number 9. So we are talking about 2 days trip. So for people having a weekend from Cairo, spending 2 days weekend trip with camping in the desert, they see history, geological history, ancient river valleys, they see petrified forest, they see Greek city, Christian history, ancient Egyptian history, beautiful lakes.
This is a cosmopolitan area.
Exactly so.
Well, unfortunately, sir, we are running out of time, but we are going to leave you with a promise to see you again and to speak in more details about this beautiful site, about El Fayoum. Mr. Samir Abbas, our Egyptologist, thank you very much for being with us, sir. Have a very good day.
You too.
And I guess this brings us to the end of this edition of The Breakfast Show. My name is Dina Hussain, and all the pleasure to have with me Ramin Abdurrahman as my Sunday morning partner. And many thanks to all of you. And until we see you again tomorrow, that's a goodbye.